They say a storm is coming in a couple days from now. Big one, heavy one. Warning us. But it's out there somewhere in the vastness of the Pacific Ocean. Right now everything seems beautiful, perfect here. What if the vastness of the Pacific Ocean, what if we translated that into the vastness of space? And what if someone broadcasted to us, say, hey, there's a storm coming soon that's going to hit the Earth. It's just out there in space. Well, it's pretty similar, right? Pretty similar forecast. We have satellites now that look at the atmosphere and the ocean and all that. Maybe there's some awareness that looks at the cosmos and space, like we look at the ocean, and can forecast various events that are going to, you know, move and impact the Earth. And maybe, in fact, they did forecast that. That has been forecast. And so they tell us, you know, get ready for the storm. So there's various things we need to do to get ready for that. Same thing, if there's a cosmic situation coming towards the Earth, they tell us to get ready for it. So maybe that storm's already hit. Maybe it hit in the 70s here, 80s, 90s. Yeah. Maybe it's already about 44 years. Or maybe 44 years into it. I was watching the sports talk about the winter baseball meetings, and they were talking about various stuff, and somehow inadvertently I was trying to turn off the TV. Somehow it shifted over to another channel, one of the, you know, network channels, and someone was singing a song, just belting it out. And I said, hey, that's a gospel song. So I turned away from it quickly, said, oh, I don't ever go to any network channel or anything. Then I said, wait a minute, you're singing a gospel song. What is this? Is this some really channel with gospel music or what? No, this is a network. Oh, it's some one of those singing competitions. And so he's just belting out Old Rugged Cross, and everyone, and after he finished, you know, everyone just yelling and screaming and just, you know, getting all frantic. Oh, it's so incredible, oh, you know. And I remember in church Sunday, a day ago, I was speaking to the leader of the church musical group. And we were talking about something, and somehow it came up, and I said, yeah, when you play music in church, you have to underplay it. And he said, yeah, they're all very good musicians, but they underplay it. You don't try to show off your musical talents in church at all. Okay. And when you're singing a gospel song, you're not supposed to show off your talents. It's not about you. So what I see is that this is a perfect example of demoralization, spiritual demoralization. Is it really demoralizes us to the popification of what is sacred, actually. We don't have to make it all overly solemn, like here we just, it's casual. But the undertones, are we're underplaying it, you know, we try to be calm. We give space for the listener to feel the sacred, whereas in the popification of what is sacred in this world, you know, they might as well have been singing, you know, some song about riots or something or whatever, you know, whatever they want to sing about. You know, it's frantic, it's desperate, it's overwrought, it's designed to get applause, it's designed to showcase the singer's talents and all this kind of stuff. And it's way off the mark. And just another example of everything that's taking place in the world right now. People have this religious phobia. Really, they do. Now, the ocean, the world is like a vast ocean of indifference right now. Vast ocean of indifference. And we might be a little island in the ocean, actually, a little island in the ocean. But you know, you're a little island somewhere in the middle of some vast ocean, and there's no, you know, mostly just complete indifference to you, complete indifference. But you know, we're islanders. We're islanders, spiritual islanders, actually. So we spend our time hearing the good news, listening to the good news, hearing the good news. Listening is different. Listening is for the purpose of critiquing. Hearing is for the purpose of going beyond the words. So here we're hearing the good news. We're hearing the good news. And it's getting easier and easier to share the good news. People don't come to this island. They're afraid. They're afraid of the good news. They rationalize this as saying, no, sour grapes, I would never go there. There's nothing there. But they're afraid of the good news, that's all. And I found it very, like the most important puzzle there is in the world. Is to find out, why are we so afraid of the good news? I was intrigued by that. I said, why am I so frightened? It's ridiculous. What is it? What's the problem? This is, you know, way more important than solving the speed of light or any scientific problem. Incomparably more important. It's the most important question there is. Why are we so frightened of the truth? And what the gospel does, the good news, is to explain why. Why are we so afraid of the truth? And just to look at it, just look at it. So a lifetime of just looking at the truth. It's very, very interesting. It's like you're digging down for the real gold. To strike a real gold mine, the mother lode of truth. Why are we so afraid? Why is everyone so afraid of truth? Well, continuity problem. Which seems very tough to pin down, right? Because it's a familiarity issue. And you can also say that because we were not honest when we tried to be greater than God in. Since we couldn't, instead of saying, oh, we try to be greater God, but we can't, we tried to get tricky about it and said that, no, we weren't trying to be greater than God. God created us in order to annihilate God. And if we don't annihilate God, and if we don't function as God created us, which would be annihilating God, then God's going to annihilate us because we've been a bad creation, as it were, bad creation. So here we are, desperately trying to figure out how to disempower God through disempowering ourselves, because we are an extension of God. We are God, and we're frightened because we can't succeed, we can't figure out yet, we're nervous, you know, and we're all posturing. Like trying to reassure one another, like, I'm working on it, are you? You're working on it? Oh, good, good. Let's make sure everybody, are you working on it? Yeah, I'm working on it. How you doing? Well, I'm feeling pretty disempowered. Okay, great, I am too. And I'm really feeling spiritually demoralized, really focusing on bodies and pop culture and all this stuff, and it's really helping out a lot. I don't feel very spiritual at all. Oh, I don't either, you know, they say. No. In fact, everybody I know, none of us feel very spiritual at all anymore. In fact, we're very much look at that with abhorrence, you know, spirit. That's not what we are. What does that have to do with us? Oh, yeah, right. What does it have to do with us? Nothing, right, nothing. This is kind of the meta-dialogue that is taking place. The unspoken dialogue, reading between the lines in this world. So everybody's kind of hanging out together and saying, this is, you know, this is really cool. I mean, I don't even think I have anything that the spirit has anything to do with me. I'm a human being, a human body. This is cool, just hanging out as a human, isn't it? It was, oh yeah, it's great. That's great, you know. Let's have a drink, you know, toast. Oh yeah, let's have a drink. Let's have a few drinks, and this is great. Human bodiness, wow. Yeah. So everybody's, you know, very much into the cool of human bodiness. Studying all sorts of form and reactions of form and all that. So you kind of think, wow, I kind of need to do that too, you know. This is what everybody does here. They act disempowered. They pretend to be disempowered. And this is what is applauded. This is where everyone's attention is on. Say, how you doing with your disempowerment? Everyone, when they meet each other in the world, if you really wanted to put a caption to their interaction, it's like, hi, how are you doing with your disempowerment? Oh, hey, how's it going? Yeah, I'm doing really actually pretty good at it. How are you doing? Ah, great. I'm doing really great at disempowerment. Yeah. Well, that's great. Well, maybe we can hang out together and share a little time of disempowerment together. Oh, sure. All right, great. Hey, what disempowering movies have you seen recently? Well, I saw this movie and I felt really disempowered watching that movie. Oh, really? I got to go see that one. I got to put that on my list. You know, that's great. This is actually what they're saying. This is actually what's being said in the world. And we're all, everyone's, how you doing? How are you doing? You winning? Oh, I'm winning. You're winning? Well, I'm winning too. We're all winning, aren't we? Yeah, we're really winning. In fact, pretty soon everybody here will be winning. And once everybody on the planet's winning, you know, that's it. We've won. And we're going to be happy forever after. Not that we're not happy now. Of course we're happy because we're winning. And we're feeling very disempowered. And that's what we want, right? So, this is the kind of dialogue that you have to put up with wherever you go in the world. Wherever you go. You go into a store with the music, it's, you know, we're losing, you know, we're winning our battle of losing. We're winning the battle of losing, basically. All the music is so spiritually demoralizing wherever you go. It's people who are, it's done by those who are working really hard at winning the game of losing, disempowering, trying to disempower themselves and everyone else, and sharing that success and disempowerment with everyone else. Make the most horrible racket. It's enough to scare you. That's one of the most frightening sounds you've ever heard, is a pack of coyotes making these god-awful noises. Yeah, those are coyotes. I remember one time they made such a racket, scared me. I didn't know what they were, scared me half to death. Talk about disempowering. Listen to a pack of coyotes with their weird howling noises and stuff. Wow, it sounds like a bunch of maniacs. I remember it sounded like a bunch of maniacs were descending upon the house. They're somehow there right near, and I didn't know what it was. I had no idea what was making all those maniacal noises, well, those coyotes. They're probably as bad or worse than hyenas. So there's something that disempowered, feeling of disempowered right there. Just add to the mix, add to the audio mix of the world. If you're listening to music in the world, it's like listening to a pack of coyotes, really. That's how demoralizing it is. What helps us is hearing the good news, actually, and feeling, wow. Not listening to it. Listening to it is just a conceptual level, however exalted the conceptual may seem. But hearing it is wow. It impacts you. You feel impacted by some, you know, intoxicating hope. I'm not always going to be suffering like this. I'm not always going to be feeling so down and dispirited. No. It's going to come to an end. And that is quite a realization. So we spend time in realization. Getting used to realization. I'm going to get free of delusion soon. The world is like a pack of coyotes. You bring the gospel to the world and they just kind of look at you like that. I remember coming across coyotes and they just look at you and say, hey, whoa, boo, you know. So they just keep looking at you. Go away, nothing. It's like, who are you? What are you doing? And why don't you go away, they're saying. okay, so no, I'm not going away. And they say, well, I'm not going away. So, oh, whatever. I'll just keep walking. And you walk, keep walking. So they're not impressed, easily impressed by us. And neither are raccoons. One time a raccoon got in our house at night, making horrible noises, tear everything up, looking for food and everything. I said, came out the door with a flashlight. No, he's came out the door, turned the light on. And the raccoon was right there looking at me. And I was looking at the raccoon. And I expect the raccoon was like looking at me, said, who are you? You know, basically, what are you doing here? I said, well, what do you mean? Who am I? Well, I live here. Well, who are you? What are you doing here? And the raccoon, like, ah. And then slowly shoved, you know, just goes around the corner, went out the cat door, got in through the cat door. You know. Raccoon was in no hurry to leave. He was invading our house, you know. Oh my gosh, they're very bold critters. Very bold critters. So the world is like that, you know. You bring the truth to the world and the world just says, ah, who are you? You know, like that. What are you doing here? What are you talking about? Now, if you don't try to tune into it, then indeed it seems very, you can't even relate to it at all. It's only when you give it some time and thought and effort and really try to tune it, it's like a radio station. Let's say there's a radio station. For example, let's say one day you're driving along with the radio on and somehow, you know, you're driving and you're getting some distance away from the transmitter, radio transmitter, and you get out of range and it gets all kind of static and, you know, it's like in between channels, you know, in between, and you're pulling in channels from like distance, bouncing. And faintly you hear like some song or something. It's like what is that song? And you start to notice it and hear it and say, wow, that sounds beautiful. What? And then it kind of fades out again as you keep driving. That's the last you hear of it. And the station you're listening to comes back in, or another one comes along. You lock into that station. But then you're thinking, you know, where was that station? Where was that station that had that beautiful music I was hearing? And you start saying, let me see if I can, you know, tune it in. And so you start adjusting the dial, moving the dial. I mean, we used to have, you turn it instead of just digital, we were able to adjust minutely and fine tune it like this with a dial. And so we try to start tuning in and say, I want to find that station. Where is it? It's got to be in here somewhere. And you really start working at it. And if you really keep working at it, you may find it here in a very faint moment or two, like, oh yeah, I just heard this song, but it's gone. Fades in and out, fades real quickly in and out. You say, well, I know there's a station. Oh, where is that station coming from? You don't know where it's coming from. So you don't know which direction to drive in, you know? But you know it's there. So this is like truth, spiritual truth. For some reason, you may catch a glimpse of it. And you just say, oh my gosh, I love that. You know, where's that coming from? And then it fades out, and you think, how do I get tuned into that again? How can I tune into that? And you start really trying. Well, this is what it's all about. Because in that trying, you get starting to get your attention focused on it. That's when you start getting real faint little echoes, you see, of truth. Enough so you realize, hey, the truth is broadcasting somewhere. You know, I just have to tune it in. Well, the truth is that truth is broadcasting everywhere, and it's our attempt to tune in something else. All these illusions, specific illusions, a term of illusions, there seem to be blocking truth and making it seem as though truth is some you know, broadcasting from far away and you're just hearing some echo. No, it's actually broadcasting right here, right now, everywhere. So in our efforts to tune into the truth, we begin to you know, catch some glimpses of it, and then we keep trying even more and more and more and more. So it takes an effort to tune into the truth. It takes an effort. It takes tenacity and determination. For instance, let's say you're studying for the bar exam and you really want to pass it, and you're just studying for weeks on end. You're so determined that you're going to pass it. Okay, well, take that kind of determination and make it even greater than that. And that's what you feel when you're trying to tune in truth, is this is just life and death. Even more than life and death. It's supremely important. So you're going to give it your full attention. Full attention. Which isn't easy to do with all these sirens. Various types, actually, the ambulance type and other types of distractions, into disempowerment. All these other radio stations are radio stations of disempowerment, singing this the siren song of disempowerment, as we're used to. So you have to really, really try to tune into the station that is playing the song of spiritual empowerment. You have to really try to hear it. We can hear that plane, but it's all dark. I don't know where the plane is, but I know it's up there somewhere. Just like that, we can hear the song of truth. We know it's somewhere. We're just not sure, you know, where is it? And we miss it because it's actually everywhere. And we're looking for it somewhere, which is why we're missing it. There's nowhere where it's not. As long as we're looking for it somewhere and not everywhere, we'll overlook it, we won't see it, we won't hear it. Because it is the song of everywhereness, of isness, the song of isness. The song of partial isness is a different channel, right? It's not the channel of truth. The song of alwaysness, the song of isness, of everywhereness, of nowness, of freedom, of indeterminacy, the song of bliss. This is the song that's always being sung everywhere. Now we're trying to hear a different song that's not always everywhere. Calm before the storm here in California. Calm before the storm. So the song of everywhereness, let's see if we can hear that song. Let's see if we can hear that song. Tune into that song. All the other stations are getting in the way. As we progress closer, nearer to hearing this song, again, the continuity problem will jump up. Don't struggle with it. Recognize it right away and say, okay, great. That just proves I'm making progress. There's the proof. Very good. Excellent feedback. And that plane, you can still hear it. Amazing. How is that possible? So like the continuity fear kicking up a noise, it just gradually diminishes. It's like a plane. The continuity fear backlash is like the plane. You heard it come rumbling over and make a big noise, and then it goes in the distance. The sound must be carrying like 30, 40 miles right now from the plane. That's amazing. But it takes a while before it dies down. So you just be patient. It's like you want the quiet to return. So you reach quietness, and suddenly the continuity fear throws an airplane across your path. Some noise. Let it pass. Let it die down. Here comes another one, but what the first one kind of. That's the longest I've ever heard. That's amazing. The sound is carrying tonight. It's just extraordinary. So it's like a spiritual path, it's like living near an airport, and you make progress, but here comes the plane coming in. Planes keep coming in, disrupt your quietness. You just have to be patient. Let it calm down again. It seems like you also hear like the freeway noise, cars on the freeway. That's at quite a distance. That's incredible. Noticed how noisy the suburbs are, actually. Here's another plane. when you really go out in the boondocks, it's absolutely quiet. You just, it's amazing, right? Because there's all this white noise, actually. And the suburbs. Life in the suburbs. Remember, that was one time a great experiment. Great American experiment. It was really like very terrible. You think, oh, I'm supposed to be happy here. This is where happiness is found. I guess that the air is so still that sound is carrying very far. Clear, still. There's not a breath of movement in the air whatsoever. So there's no, the air is conducting sound. To an extraordinary extent. Like those coyotes, who knows where they were? That was quite a distance away, yet it sounded very, could hear it very strongly. So if you quiet your mind, like this quiet air, you can hear what seems to be faint, far away. Maybe truth seems far away and faint, and yet you can hear it and be aware of it. Told is that reality generates its own buzz, its own bliss inherently. It's this that we're looking for. Look, this is what we need to feel. It's not caused by anything, it's uncaused. It's the disposition of reality. The inherent disposition. And this is actually our inherent disposition as well. Feel like a cat right now. I mean, you must be able to hear distant sounds. See, I heard this. Or maybe a motorcycle, but. Still aren't amazing. That's why, like, your dog or your cat can be sitting in your driveway waiting for you. You say, how did you know I was coming? They heard you, like, maybe a mile or two away. They know the sound of your car. They figured that out. Because right now, I'm able to hear a mile or two away. So if I can hear that, and their hearing is like 100 times better than ours, they can maybe be able to pick up our car from across town when it's this still. They may be able to hear us when we leave the market, where we are. They may know where we are, more than we realize, when it's like this still. Well, in a spirit, all of reality is perfectly still in a certain way. So maybe spirit can hear where all is, all aware of all. It knows us, knows where, what we're doing at all times. Of course, it might be hard for the dog to hear the electric cars now. But they might give us some sort of different tone that we don't hear. See, I just heard that vehicle. That vehicle's across town almost. Wow. It's like hearing miles away. And here's, wow, it's really amazing. Maybe it's a good meditation just to be quiet and see what can you hear? What can you hear? Does space have a sound? Does spaciousness have a sound? How do we know it doesn't have a sound, actually? Does no sound have a sound? Does pure potentiality have a sound? Maybe that sound is the sound of silence. So, this video is an example of introspection, inquiry. This is what I used to do a lot of for many, many, many years. Maybe all sound is just a playing with silence. At its root, it all contains the silence, because all contains the pure potentiality. All is the pure potentiality, actually, which is a way to say all is God. Possible to see the godness of all, actually. If we just flip the script, the perceptual script. So, all is God. It is possible to recognize this, because every last thing we see is just the play, our playing with pure potentiality in whatever thing that we're seeing. That is also pure potentiality. This table here could be absolutely anything whatsoever this next instant. Therefore, it is pure potentiality. Therefore, everything is God. Everything is equally God. I certainly see the theory behind this now. So you see how effective this type of meditation is. I'm able to recognize that all is God, theoretically. There's no real difference at all among anything in that regard. It's just a momentary appearance. All is just momentary appearance, but it's all is God right now. Again, this table, even though it appears to be granite, it's just an appearance of light, and it could appear as anything at all or not appear. Pure potential is, this table is just, pure potential. So even our play with pure potential is pure potential. Pure potential never is defined at all. So when you quiet the mind down, you're able to recognize something that may have escaped your attention before, something that seems very subtle. I had never seen this before, like this, that all is God, that whatever form we think we're seeing is actually could be anything else. All potential and possibilities are there. It's still pure potential. Everything is pure potential. All is pure potential. It means all is God. God is all. All is God. God is all. anybody could say that this so-called emptiness here is really complete fullness. Anything at all could arise. Anywhere. But so how is it empty? It's full. A form, clear light. Form of everything. This would be spiritual vision, to flip the emphasis, change the emphasis of perception. It's difficult to come out of this because everything has become so still. I wonder if the stillness of the evening helped me out. It seems like if I were to move, it would feel weird. So maybe it would seem really weird. When you see all as God. See, we're thinking there's God and then there's form. I'm saying all form, everything we're seeing, all is God. All is pure potentiality. Everything being, everything is completely indeterminate. There's no two moments are not bound together. Everything is free to be anything at all. All potential. Or whatever. It's free to be all. All potential is present always, everywhere. So once we see that, it'd be totally weird to not see that. Totally weird. Okay, just coming. Stillness of the evening, that really has a helpful effect to it, for sure. Wow. If you can tune into it like that and try to hear everything, to has become super attentive. The mind quiets way down. So there you go, there's an example of this quiet contemplation that the mind stills way down. And this fundamental was able to entertain the fundamentally essential recognitions. So all is God, God is all. 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 I could probably stay here quiet for hours. Yeah, but you get the idea. All is God, God is all. So I'm going to try to and see where it goes from here. Very excellent. Okay. That's it for this one.